this late in the afternoon in the summertime. Appreciate that. As many of you, I see some familiar faces from earlier today, so you can see that it's a busy day for us here at CSIS. We, as always, thank you all for making the time to come and see the folks and the presentations that we have lined up for you. Today, we're extremely fortunate, through the good offices of the Chinese Embassy here in Washington, to have three very distinguished visitors who are all from the Foreign Policy Advisory Committee of China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs. They're here in the U.S. For several days to sort of get a sense from the U.S. think tank and official community as to the status of Sino-U.S. relations. Timing is perfect, of course, with the strategic and economic dialogue winding up today in Beijing. They're here to talk to us about the concept of building a new model of major country relations, and we're very eager to hear what they have to say. Let me take a moment to introduce Ambassador Jia Peixin, who served as ambassador to the United Kingdom for China in the early 2000s through 2007. And he's held a number of roles in the Chinese government, including serving on the Standing Committee of the 11th National People's Congress from 2008 to 2013, and of course has extensive diplomatic experience. He's going to kick us off today and deliver some prepared remarks from the podium, and then I understand his two colleagues will also share some remarks with us, and then we'll open it up to the audience for some question and answer period. So with that, Ambassador Jia, please, and welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a pleasure to be invited to CSIS. It's a very prestigious research institute. Well known. So it's a pleasure. I worked in the liaison office in the 1970s here in Washington. So it's a great pleasure to be back. Over the years, I've worked many years in foreign ministry on the U.S. desk or Department of North America and Oceania Affairs. And in the 90s, I left the area but still watching the relations closely. So today, I wish to share with you my views on building a new model of major country relationship between China and the United States. As you all know, in June 2013, President Xi Jinping had a meeting with President Obama at Annenberg, California. And at the meeting, the two presidents reached a very important agreement on building a new model of major country relationship. That historical meeting charted the course for future growth of Sino-American relations and send a very positive signal to the world. The two sides reaffirmed this commitment in their subsequent communications. So it is becoming increasingly evident that this new model of major country relationship between China and the US is the right choice. There are three prominent features of that new model of relationship. They are non-conflict and non-confrontation, mutual respect, and win-win cooperation. Non-conflict or non-confrontation requires the two sides to view each other's strategic intentions in an objective and sensible way. Stay as partners instead of adversaries or rivals, and properly handle their differences and disputes through dialogue and cooperation instead of taking a confrontational approach. Mutual respect requires the two sides to respect each other's choice of social systems and development path, respect each other's core interests and major concerns. Seeking common grounds while shelving differences, uphold inclusiveness and mutual learning, and make progress side by side. Win-win cooperation requires the two sides to abandon the zero-sum mentality and to accommodate the other's interests while seeking what's wrong and promote common development while developing itself and continue to deepen the pattern of shared interests. I think building a new model of major country relationship is of great significance. First, it is in the fundamental interests of our two peoples. The United States is the largest developed country. China still remains the largest developing country. Our two economies are the two largest economies now in the world. So China and the United States share broad common interests, and there are many areas where we can cooperate. The cooperation based on the principle of equality and mutual benefit has brought enormous benefits to our two peoples and will deliver even more benefits in the future. The interdependence of China and the U.S. has reached an unprecedented level that neither country could thrive without the other. A good relationship benefits both sides, while confrontation will do harm to both. So it is a very wise and right choice for both sides to build a new model of major country relationship. Second, it is conducive not only to peace and stability in the Asia-Pacific region, but in the world as a whole. The development of China-U.S. relations has made great contribution to peace, stability, and the prosperity of the two countries, the region, and the world. Facts since the establishment of diplomatic relations 35 years ago showed that China-U.S. cooperation is an anchor for world peace and stability. And win-win cooperation as the goal of this model will not only benefit the two countries, but also contribute to the world at large. Where China-U.S. relations are headed has an enormous impact on the whole world. If the bilateral relations go smoothly, world peace will stand a good chance. Third, it is also a new contribution to the new structure of international relations and international order, world order. There is such an interdependence and connectivity in today's world. The relations among countries are no longer a zero-sum game. The 19th century solutions can no longer work to solve the 21st century problems. If our goal is to build a 21st century world order, our minds and ideas should advance with the time and replace the old ideas with the new. We should abandon the Cold War mentality, build new concepts of crossing a river in the same boat, and a win-win cooperation, and foster a sense of human community, of common destiny, common interests, and common responsibilities. To build a new model of major country relationship, China and the U.S. need to take joint efforts to follow the trend of the world development. It will contribute to the early establishment of a more balanced international structure. Building a new model of a major country relationship is not only of great significance, but it is of high possibility. Firstly, it complies with the trend of time. In the 21st century, peace development and win-win cooperation are the trend of the times and the common aspiration of the people. With the growing trend of multipolar world, economic globalization, the fast emergence of information society, countries are forming a community of common destiny, where there is either security for all or security for none. Major countries cannot bear the cost of completely becoming rivals. China and the US are both permanent members of the Security Council. We share the special responsibilities for international peace and stability. Many issues simply cannot get resolved without cooperation from the two countries. China and the US are now working together to build a new model of major country relationship, which demonstrates the determination of both
to break the historic Thucydides trap. This is called for by the new realities of the world in the 21st century. It is also in conformity with the long-term interests of both countries and the expectations expectations of the international community. Secondly, it follows the trend of economic globalization. In the era of economic globalization, the world is in the midst of rapid development and profound transformation. Many global issues are becoming more acute and more prominent. No matter how strong a country is, it simply cannot resolve all those problems by itself. In face of these issues, no country can stand aloof or meet challenges on its own. The only way out is to enhance international cooperation. Only if each party has the determination, wisdom, and willingness to cooperate can they seize the opportunity to create an even brighter future for the world. China and the U.S. are already cooperating in so many fields, including international and regional security issues, non-proliferation, counterterrorism, Korean Peninsula, the Iranian nuclear issue, global economic governance, climate change, cross-border crimes, disease control, and infrastructure building, etc. With the new model as the framework, all these will have a clearer sense of direction and greater incentives and closer coordination and introduce even more tangible results for our two peoples. Third, the cooperation between China and the U.S. has already laid a solid foundation for building a new model of major country relationship. Compared with 35 years ago, great progress has been made in China-U.S. relations, which few people then would have imagined. Today, China and the U.S. are each other's second largest trade partners. In the past decade, China is U.S.'s fastest growing exporting market, and the largest. China is also the largest holder of U.S. Treasury. Last year, the bilateral trade volume topped $500 billion, and the two-way investment approached $100 billion. Our interests have become increasingly interwoven. Every year, close to 5 million people are traveling across the Pacific. Nowadays, there is a flight between the two countries every 24 minutes. So thousands of people are traveling across the Pacific every day. The interaction between local communities have also increased. There are 41 pairs of sister province-state relationship and 201 pairs of sister city relationship between our two countries. The two presidents meet more often, than before. And there are over 90 mechanisms for dialogue and cooperation between the two countries, including the strategic and economic dialogue you are talking about, and also high-level consultations on people-to-people exchanges. All these mechanisms provide the institutional guarantee for timely handling relative issues between our two countries. There is no doubt that given to the differences in social systems, in the development path, in the development level of each economy, and history and cultural tradition, US and China do not see eye to eye on many issues. It is only natural that the two countries do have disagreements or differences. But those differences and disagreements should not disrupt the building of a new model of major country relationship between China and the United States. Firstly, I would emphasize that our common interests far outweigh our differences, and cooperation far outweighs competition. This is the basic feature and mainstream of China-U.S. relations. Secondly, the two presidents have made firm commitment to build a new model of major country relationship, which has also gained support from peoples from all walks of life in both countries. I'm sure that the two sides have enough wisdom and capability to manage their differences from disrupting the overall relationship. Certainly, many differences, I think, between China and US are really caused by lack of mutual understanding. I believe that through communications, through more active exchanges, the two peoples will gain a better understanding of each other, and our views towards each other will be more objective, sensible, and comprehensive, and our differences will gradually get narrowed or reduced. The view that there always have been fierce conflicts between an established power and emerging power, and they're bound to fall into the dynamic of confrontation, I think is completely outdated. Mankind has entered the 21st century when the basic framework of major country relationship is featured by interdependence. Cooperative as well as competitive. Therefore, the possibility of major powers coming into direct or all-round confrontation is diminishing. More importantly, China's firm adherence to the path of peaceful development has broken the old cycle that a country is bound to seek hegemony when it gets stronger. What has happened since China's reform and opening up shows that this path is not only a thorough path, but it will become even more wider. Of course, the building of a new model of major country relationship between China and US is an unprecedented endeavor, a long-term and arduous mission. It simply couldn't accomplish in a single stroke. So it needs the concerted involvement and tireless efforts from both sides. But as long as we are firm in our determination and keep forging ahead, US-China relations will embrace a bright future. I think at present we should focus on the following areas. First, we should further enhance political and strategic mutual trust. We need to maintain the momentum of close exchanges at the top and at various levels, deepen mutual understanding, and avoid misconceptions, misunderstanding, misreading, or misjudgment. Since the reform and opening up, China has made remarkable achievements and witnessed great changes. However, China remains the largest developing country in the world. It still has a long way to go before it can basically achieve modernization. China is committed to peaceful development and remains a positive force for peace and development. Never will a more powerful China seek hegemony or dominance over other nations. I think the US needs to have a correct understanding of China's strategic intention in this regard. Mutual respect, of course, is the political prerequisite for a new model of relations. That requires the two sides to respect each other's sovereignty and territorial integrity, respect each other's right to choose its own development path and social system, and each should respect the other's core interests and major concerns, and act cautiously on sensitive issues. Expand the common interest in a positive and constructive way, and view China-US relations with a long-term vision. Such respect is not a favor, I mean, given by one party to the other. It is a reciprocal process and a two-way street. Well, you gain respect from others only when you, you know, respect others as well. Only by viewing each other's development as an opportunity instead of a threat, as a partner instead of an adversary, and pursuing contact and dialogue instead of containment, can China and the U.S. make steady and solid progress in their relations? Second, we should expand the pragmatic cooperation in various areas. There is a high degree of complementarity between our two economies, which offers bright prospects and great potential for mutual beneficial cooperation. The two sides need to seek the opportunities of reform in both countries to turn the deepening of such reform into a process of strengthening pragmatic cooperation. We should expand areas of cooperation, create new highlights of cooperation, and open new prospects of cooperation. Take solid steps to bolster our cooperation. We should further expand our bilateral trade. At the present, China-U.S. economic and trade relations witness a sound momentum of development and with great potential to be tapped. China's imports are expected to approach $2 trillion U.S. dollars annually in the next 5 years. When maintaining to expand the scope of good trade, China is also accelerating to develop the scope of service trade and will further broaden the opening up of service trade to the outside world, which will bring development opportunities to bilateral economic and trade cooperation. China welcomes and encourages American companies to seize the opportunities. Likewise, we also hope that the American government would ease its control over high-tech products export to China, which will be conducive for American companies to account more market shares in China. Trade liberalization and facilitation are the important guarantees for the expansion of international trade. China is ready to work with the U.S. to counter various trade protectionism, properly handle disputes in our economic and trade relations, and pursue trade relieving measures with caution. We should also enhance the two-way investment. It is expected that in the next 5 years, China will make overseas investment totaling $500 billion U.S. dollars. That means $100 billion each year in the next 5 years. Since many Chinese entrepreneurs show strong interest in American market, it is hoped that the U.S. government would eliminate some prejudices or settle some obstacles faced by Chinese companies to invest in the U.S. and provide a fair and hospitable environment for Chinese investment in the U.S. We need to work for the early breakthroughs in the negotiation of bilateral investment agreements to boost the two-way investment. It is also necessary to increase dialogue and cooperation in agriculture, energy, environment, climate change, infrastructure, etc. And we should launch a number of major joint operations in those fields, which will bring benefits to both our people. Such cooperation can help enhance confidence of people towards building a new model of major country relationship. Third, we should continue to increase communication and coordination on important international as well as regional issues. Nowadays, the world, especially Asia-Pacific region, is grappling with challenges and problems. China and the U.S. should enhance communication to help develop sound interaction in this region. China and the U.S. are both located in the Asia-Pacific region, where the two countries have the most active interaction, where conflicts are most likely to occur. So pushing forward the construction of a new model of major country relationship between China and U.S. should start from the Asia-Pacific, I think. We need enhanced communication and coordination on issues like the nuclear issue of the Korean Peninsula, the Iranian nuclear issue, the Syria, North and South Sudan, Afghanistan, and the other regional hotspots issues to seek proper settlements. It is also necessary to actively expand cooperation in tackling global issues such as climate change, energy security, food security, cyber security, and provide more public goods to the international community. Fourth, I think we should further boost the bilateral people-to-people and cultural exchanges. We need to continue to increase dialogue and exchanges between our legislatures and local governments, promote interactions between the business community, the academic community, and increase mutual visits of young people and students. More frequent and deep-going exchanges in all these sectors will enhance mutual understanding and friendship and ensure that the forces and voices in support of China-U.S. cooperation will prevail in public opinion of the two countries, which would consolidate the public opinion and social foundation for the construction of a new model of major country relationship. To sum it up, I think the consensus reached by the two presidents have pointed out the right direction and has drawn the blueprint for future growth of Sino-American relations. If we join hands and work together, I think a bright future awaits China-U.S. relations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Jha. And now I think we're going to have some comments from your colleagues. We'll start with Ambassador Li Fenglin, who also is a member, of course, of the Foreign Policy Advisory Committee, China's former ambassador to Russia. He currently serves as a member of both the Foreign Policy Committee and as director of the Euro-Asian Development Research Institute in China, which is under the State Council's Development Research Center. Prior to these positions, as I mentioned, he worked as ambassador to Russia from 1995 to 1998, and also served as ambassador to Romania and Moldova and Bulgaria, so much experience in the Eurasian area. So we would certainly like to hear from you on that area. I believe our two colleagues here will be using interpretation as well to make their remarks.
Thank you.
And so we will have the interpreter go ahead and do that as we go along. Thank you.
I say only a few words for begin. I have been in Washington many times, but it is my first visit to your center because this building is new one. I am very happy to participate in this meeting. I'm ready to discuss to you frankly any question interesting you. Thank you.
We'll move on to Mr. Zhu. Zhu Yinghuang is also a member, of course, of the Foreign Policy Affairs Committee. Prior to holding this position, Mr. Zhu served as the editor-in-chief of China Daily between 1993 and 2004. He's also worked as a member of the Foreign Affairs Committee of the 10th National People's Political Consultative Conference, the CPPCC. And in addition to his position in the foreign ministry, he is also the vice chairman of the All China Translators Association, vice chairman of the China National Committee for Pacific Economic Cooperation, special advisor to the China-U.S. Exchange Foundation, and editor-in-chief emeritus of China Daily Newspaper Group. So long experience in the media sector. So we welcome your comments. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, Johnson. I think I would rather speak English so to save time. Besides, my English is not good enough. But the good thing is the poor and simple English will be easier for you to understand.
非常好了。
So my pleasure to be here, and also my pleasure to be with the two very distinguished ambassadors. They know the Chinese foreign policy so well, and they can make China's stand very clear to you. But I was a journalist, not a very good one. But I have a young colleague, Chen Weihua, working in Washington. I always envy you that he can stay in this beautiful city and working on covering the United States. He knows China-U.S. relations. He knows America much better than I do. Next time, you should invite him here. And as a journalist, I have my observation, which is somewhat different from the officials, because journalists, both Chinese and Americans, tend to be sometimes take a little bit of a negative attitude towards things, asking questions. So my observation is that after the Sunnyland summit was regarded was hailed by the Chinese media as a milestone in the bilateral relations. So after the summit, people did have high expectation of the summit, believing that China-U.S. relations will progress faster because our two top leaders are all committed to the new model of major country relations. However, it seems to me that such an encouraging scenario has not really appeared for some reasons. And in fact, some scholars, both China and American, believe that the U.S.-China relations is on the downward trend. The road is bumpy. We do have some problems. And China is blaming U.S., U.S. is blaming China. I'm a diplomat, so they can talk very peacefully. But between media, between the ordinary people, you know, when you hear the American or Chinese officials talking about the relations, you get quite optimistic, you know. Things are going fine. But when you watch TV, when you read newspapers, you find we have so many problems. It doesn't look like so promising. So, you know, U.S. is blaming China for being more assertive or provocative, aggressive, or using Hegel's words as unilateral, destabilizing the region. So, and believing China is making some trouble in attention in the Asia-Pacific region. But China is getting more and more suspicious of an American real intention in Asia-Pacific. In spite of the fact that the Obama and the Macron officials repeatedly saying we're not going to contain China. In spite of they say that we don't take position on the territory issues, disputes, on the sovereignty. In spite of that, what we have seen, what they say, what we did, is actually contrary. They are emboldened. We use the embolden or encourage some countries, Japan, Vietnam, and Philippines, to take more provocative actions against China. As our ambassador said, all these troubles were started up, not by China. That is for certain. We don't talk about our long history, how history records can prove that these islands are, belong to China. You can read the history books. I'm talking about current time. All these troubles were started up by Japan, nationalization, by Philippines, up until late 1970. They never had a Huaiyang Island in their map. Okay. Also, like Vietnam, we are drilling a well in South China Sea near our Shisha Island. It's only within 20 nautical miles. And yet, we are being blamed by many people, including the media in the world. People say it's like the big country is bullying small countries, but many Chinese believes we are being too passively reactive, too passive. It is the fact that the small countries are bullying a big country because they are being supported by superpower. I'm not saying this is the official stand, but I'm saying that what I have read in the media and the public opinion. On the website, I won't be able to tell you because that would be even more aggressive comments on all these things. So what I mean is that we do seem to have a lot of problems that how did it all happen? Maybe it happened when the Obama's Asia trip, that Chinese call it a containment trip. Some countries call it a reassurance trip. But whatever the name you give it, but the fact is, since the pivot to Asia policy, Asia no longer become so peaceful. Before that, for so many years, Asia was a peaceful region. Every country was developing so fast in economy. So we do have a problem. So what are we going to do? This is the issue that I'm thinking. I don't think I can solve, but you people, we together, maybe we can solve. But we have good news. Good news, the SED is being held in Beijing, and I hope they will discuss, address all the key issues between the in the relations. And another good news is Obama is going to Beijing maybe in November, meeting Xi, and hopefully after more than 1 year's Sunnyland summit, they will come up with more substantial progress and more creative, the word you use, the creative measures in improving China-U.S. relations. Because the impression, the strongest impression I get since I came to U.S. this time, is everybody we talked to said China-U.S. relations is extremely important. We cannot afford either side. We cannot afford a confrontational policy. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. Appreciate your candor. I'd like to ask a question before we turn it over to the audience and just try to draw together some themes from each of the sets of comments. You know, next door in our South China Sea session today, obviously we heard different views about maps and other things from various different parties. But at the very end of our session, we had a mock sort of simulated meeting of the U.S. Principles Committee, right, where there's a simulated challenge that's occurred in the region, and we have people playing the roles of the individual cabinet secretaries, and there's a discussion, which I thought was quite rich, the little bit I was able to attend before coming here. And so I guess I would say you're the Foreign Policy Advisory Committee of the Foreign Ministry. So when you sit down in that kind of a similar context to discuss these challenges that you've laid out and make your recommendations to President Xi and the rest of the leadership, how do you think about the challenge? Because I know we, certainly in think tanks and also in the U.S. government, think a lot about this. How do you think about the challenge of operationalizing the concept of a new style of major country relations? And what kind of recommendations or advice might you share with your leaders that perhaps you could share with us, if in general terms?
Actually, the issue of the South China Sea has not just emerged today. It's been for a long while.
中国对南海诸岛及其附近海域拥有无可争辩的主权，这个我们有充分的历史依据，也有充分的法理依据。
China enjoys indisputable sovereignty over the islands and reefs in the South China Sea and its adjacent waters. This is backed up by solid historical and legal evidence.
同时呢，中国一贯主张关于南海的争议，这个南海的争议，这关键问题就是，周边一些国家非法的侵占了中国的南海的一些岛屿，引起的关于岛屿的主权争议，以及海洋划界主张方面相互重叠。
The crux of the disputes over the South China Sea issue is the illegal occupation and invasion by some neighboring countries of the South China Sea and its islands. Hence, the disputes over the sovereignty and the disputes over the overlapping maritime interests and rights and as well as maritime demarcation.
那么中国在南海问题上的主张是一贯的，我们认为这些争议 应该通过直接当事方，双方在尊重历史事实和尊重国际法的基础上，通过和平谈判寻求得到解决。China's
position regarding the South China Sea issue is consistent. We believe these disputes should be resolved through peaceful dialogue and consultation by parties directly concerned with respect to historical facts and international law. These issues should be resolved bilaterally.
那么在这些争议解决以前，各方都应该保持冷静和克制的态度，防止这些问题复杂化，扩大化。
Pending an ultimate solution of these disputes, all parties should remain calm and exercise restraint so as to avoid a complication and escalation of these issues.
保持南海成为一个和平的海洋，友好的海洋，平静的海洋。
So as to ensure the South China Sea will remain a sea of peace, friendship, and tranquility.
同时我们也主张在最终解决以前也可以探索一些新的方法，比如讲各自争议共同开发。
And also, pending the ultimate settlement, we can also explore some new and creative ways to resolve the issue, such as shelving the differences and conducting joint development.
这个世界上关于海洋争议并不仅仅是中国有海洋争议。自从海洋法公布以后，据我了解，世界上大概有60多个国家跟其他国家都有海岛主权争议跟海洋划界的争议。
As a matter of fact, the maritime disputes in the world is not just limited to China. As far as I know, after the issuance of the maritime law, over 60 countries in the world have disputes, either regarding the sovereignty or regarding maritime demarcation.
这种争议最好的解决办法就是由当事国通过谈判来解决。
The best way to resolve these disputes and issues is for the parties relevant, for the parties directly concerned to sit down and have talks.
大家可能知道中国有14个陆地邻国。过去我们跟14个陆地邻国的边界都没有划定。
You may know that China has 14 land neighbors. Sometime before decades ago, the border between these neighbors are undecided.
那么经过多年的双边的直接外交谈判，现在我们已经跟12个国家，已经把那个边界问题已经彻底解决。
After years of bilateral direct diplomatic negotiation, we have now ultimately resolved the border issue with 12 neighbors.
现在唯一没有解决的就是我们的南部边界，跟我们南部最大的邻国，一个是印度，然后另外还有一个不丹。
The only remaining issue unsolved are with our largest neighbor, India, and another, Bhutan. Those are in the southern borders.
那么即使跟印度边界问题还没有解决，但双方一直是在保持着双边的谈判。
And although the border disputes with India remains unresolved, our two sides maintain bilateral negotiation.
那么我们跟印度在90年代就达成一个协议，就是在边界问题彻底解决以前，双方都应该保持克制，保持边境地区的和平与安宁，防止边界问题影响整个中印关系的发展。
Back in the 1990s, China and India have reached an agreement. Pending the ultimate solution of the boundary issue, two sides should exercise restraint in order to ensure peace and tranquility of the border region and prevent the border issue or boundary issue from affecting the overall relationship.
那么我想对待海洋方面的海洋的主权、岛屿的主权争议也好，海洋划界这些问题也好，最好的办法也是通过双边的直接谈判来求得解决。
This also applies to maritime disputes. The best way is through bilateral direct talks.
当然就是说事关到领土主权的问题是高度敏感的问题。解决这些问题需要有政治的智慧，需要有政治的决断，也需要时间，也需要有合适的气氛和条件。
Of course, issues regarding territorial sovereignty are highly sensitive ones. A final resolution requires not only political wisdom, resolve, but also takes time, as well as appropriate atmosphere and conditions.
所以在彻底解决以前，我们就要双方都要努力来创造这样的次分和条件，而不应该说关于这些岛屿的争议，毕竟不是中非关系的全部，也不是中越关系的全部，也不是中日关系的全部，不应该让这些问题来影响双边关系的发展。
That's why pending an ultimate resolution, both sides should work hard to create necessary atmosphere and conditions. After all, China's relations with either the Philippines, Vietnam, or Japan is much larger than those disputes over these islands. And these disputes should by no means be allowed to affect the overall bilateral relations.
比如讲这个钓鱼岛的问题，它不是今天才存在的，是早就存在。在中日关系正常化。 和中日签订和平条约的时候啊，这些问题也存在。但是当时啊，中国领导人就提出来一个，就叫搁置争议。哎。For
example, with regard to the 钓鱼岛 issue, it's not an issue that has emerged only today. Rather, it's been around for a long, long time. It was there at the time of normalization of diplomatic relations between China and Japan, and at the time of the signing of the peace treaty. But at that time, the Chinese leaders put forward a concept of shelving the disputes.
我想研究国际问题的人都很清楚，邓小平访问日本并且签订中日和平友好条约的时候啊，有记者就问到钓鱼岛的问题。
I believe those of you interested in international relations are familiar with Mr. Deng Xiaoping's trip to Japan, during which he signed with the Japanese side a treaty on peace and friendship. During that trip, he was asked by a journalist on the question of 钓鱼岛.
那么邓小平当时就表示，我们的钓鱼岛拥有无可争辩的主权.
Deng Xiaoping said then that we in China enjoys indisputable rights. Sovereignty over
钓鱼岛，但是像钓鱼岛这样的问题，也许我们这一代的智慧不够，这个问题啊可以放一放，留给今后的子孙后代来解决。He
also said that for us to resolve the 钓鱼岛 issue, maybe our generation do not have enough wisdom, so we can shelve this issue and leave it for future generations to solve.
所以尽管 钓鱼岛问题当时是存在的，但是中日之间呢有一个默契，就是要把这个问题啊搁在一边，不让这个问题影响中日关系的正常化，也不让这个问题影响中日签订和平友好条约。From
this, you can see that the issue of the dispute over 钓鱼岛 existed back then, but the two sides had a tacit agreement, that is to shelve this dispute. So that it will not affect the overall relationship, affect the normalization of diplomatic relations, as well as the signing of the peace treaty.
但是今天为什么钓鱼岛的问题变得这么突出呢？
But why has this issue suddenly emerged today?
这主要就是因为日本政府啊，他把钓鱼岛他要国有化，他国有化，而且呢，日本呢，他第一，他否认中国的钓鱼岛拥有主权；第二，他否认。 中日之间曾经就有钓鱼岛问题，有默契，他连默契都不承认。第三，他甚至不承认钓鱼岛问题是一个有争议的问题，这个就太过分了。This
issue suddenly cropped up because of Japanese government's so-called nationalization of these islands. Because Japan denied China's sovereignty over these islands, it even denied that we once had a tacit agreement over this. And even deny that there are disputes over
钓鱼岛。怎么能说没有争议呢？是不是啊？明明中国拥有主权，你说你拥有主权，这不是争议吗？
How can I say that there are no disputes over 钓鱼岛? China says it has sovereignty over these islands, while Japan claims it has sovereignty. So this is dispute.
你说过去没有，他不承认有默契，没有默契，邓小平是在。 日本是在公众场合回答记者提问的， 当时日本的领导人也在场，没有人讲一句不同的意见，而且拼命鼓掌，说邓小平讲得好。
And how can you deny there was once an agreement over this issue? Because Mr. Deng Xiaoping answered a question in public. The Japanese leaders were also present. Nobody disagreed. They even applauded, saying that Deng Xiaoping said, made a good point.
所以这个问题啊，不是中国引起的，是日本引起的。当然我认为日本人这么做他是有目的的，他是为了他国内的政治需要。
So this issue is not provoked by the Chinese side, but rather by the Japanese side. I believe Japan has its own intention or motives. It's intended to serve its own domestic political agenda.
当然，尽管讲了这么多，中国对日本的政策并没有改变。
For all that I have mentioned, China's Japan policy has not changed.
日本还是我们的近邻，一衣带水。我们是希望跟日本搞好关系的，对吧？但是呢，中日关系要搞好，只能在中日之间四个文件的基础上，才能搞好。
Japan is still our close neighbor. We are separated only by a narrow strip of water, and we still hope to improve our relations with Japan. But this relationship must be based on the four documents between China and Japan.
那么这个四个文件啊，当中有一个非常重要的内容。就是必须正确对待历史，
An important principle enshrined in these four documents is that we must face history squarely.
叫前世之不忘，后世之师。我们只有吸取历史的教训，才能避免二次大战这样的人类大灾难再次发生。
In China, we say that.History, if not forgotten, can serve as an important lesson for the future. That means we should learn lessons from history, and only by doing so can we ensure that such disasters and catastrophes like the World War II will not happen again.
二次大战期间，中国和美国并肩战斗，我们两国都付出了巨大的努力，才赢得了反法西斯战争的胜利。这个成果来之不易，应该倍加珍惜。
During the Second World War, China and the United States fought side by side. We worked extremely hard to fight fascism and achieved notable results. These achievements do not come easily and should be all the more cherished.
我们提倡不要忘记历史啊，不是为了延续仇恨，同样是为了向前看，是为了不要重犯历史的错误。
We say history should not be forgotten, not in order to perpetuate hatred from history, but rather to ensure that history will not be repeated so that we can look forward towards the future.
但是很不幸的是，现在在日本，这些当权的人物就根本不能正确地对待历史。最典型的就是他的首相去拜访，亚索库尼舒尔，而且这里面有十四个甲级战犯供奉着。
Unfortunately, Japanese leaders and politicians cannot face history squarely. The most visible example is Prime Minister's visit to the Yasukuni Shrine, where it enshrines 14 Class A criminals during World War II.
简而言之啊，我们是希望改善跟日本的关系的，但是呢。这个现在关键是取决于日本。
In a word, we hope to improve our relations with Japan, but the ball is in the court of the Japanese side.
那么对日本来讲啊，有三个我认为很重要的问题。第一个就是怎么样正确的对待历史。
For the Japanese side, I believe the following three points are crucial. First, how to view history squarely.
第二个怎么处理好钓鱼岛的问题。
Second, how to properly resolve the issue of 钓鱼岛。
第三个还有一个很根本的问题，到底日本把一个正在发展的中国看成是伙伴呢，还是对手，甚至是敌人？因为现在日本很多政客，他跑到世界上各地都说，现在中国是严重的威胁。 如果这个问题不解决啊，他不可能对中国采取正确的政策。
The third, also the fundamental issue, is how does Japan view China, a country that is making progress? Does Japan view China as a partner or an adversary or even an enemy? Because we see Japanese political leaders trumpeting the so-called China threat theory around the world. If this issue is not resolved, then Japan, I'm afraid, cannot pursue the right policy towards China.
当然，日本是美国重要的盟国。 只要是你们的盟国，我觉得美国也有义务啊，劝劝日本，采取一个正确的政策。I
know Japan is an important ally of the United States. So, if that's the case, I believe the U.S. also has the responsibility to persuade and convince Japan to pursue the right policy.
是盟国做了错事也要批评的，不能因为盟国就是非不分，是吧？ 你自己家里的小孩做了坏事，你还要批评他呢，是不是啊？你为了帮助他纠正呢，更何况你盟国，是吧？绝对不能是非不分，尤其在对待历史这样的重大问题上，对吧？Even
as Japan is a U.S. ally, a key ally, if it made a mistake, the U.S. should stand for justice and principles instead of combining right and wrong. We all know that even if your kid made a mistake, you will shoulder the responsibility and criticize him so that he will not make the same mistake again, let alone an ally. So the U.S. should not confide right and wrong in particular on such important issues as history.
我回答的长了一点啊，这个请大家原谅。
I hope you can bear with my long answer.
All right, in the interest of time, why don't we open it up to the audience here and get them involved. We'll start right here with the woman right there. No, behind you. Just wait for the microphone. And please, please introduce yourself and do confine yourself to a question rather than a speech. Thank you.
Yes, my name is Tep. I'm with EIR. And I would like to ask you to elaborate more on the new Silk Road concept, which is also, as your speech, reflecting very much the principles of the Peace of Westphalia, that the policy has to be in the interest of the other. And you mentioned the Bering Strait. Does that mean you are intending to extend the Silk Road to the Bering Strait also?
没有完全听明白，你听，你跟我简单翻译吧。Excuse
me, what's your question? Is it when pursuing our own interests, we should take into consideration others' interests? Is that what you mean?
I meant that the concept of the new Silk Road is...
Silk Road, you mean?
New Silk Road.
Silk Road.
Silk Road. Is a policy of the common interest of mankind, which very much reflects the idea of operating in the interest of the other. And, you know, since this has been in the ancient history a platform to exchange ideas, culture, and get mutual understanding, that maybe one can think about extending that Silk Road even more than just Central Asia or the Maritime Silk Road. And would it be a way of bridging the relationship between the United States and China, you know, to give it substance, to have common aims which would be in the benefit of both countries.
Thank you.
丝绸之路的问题啊，我来回答一下啊。这个去年9月份，习近平主席访问哈萨克斯坦的时候，就提出来要建设丝绸之路经济带。后来他在访问东盟的时候又提出来要建立21世纪的海上丝绸之路，我们中国简单的称为“一带一路”。
Let me take your question on the New Silk Road. During President Xi Jinping's visit to Kazakhstan in September last year, he put forward the idea of building a Silk Road economic belt. And later on, during his visit to ASEAN countries, he put forward the idea of building a 21st century maritime Silk Road.
这个丝绸之路啊，大家都知道是2000多年前就开始了，中国的汉代啊就开始有丝绸之路。
The Silk Road started back in China's Han Dynasty more than 2,000 years ago. It goes through to Europe all the way.
那么海上丝绸之路呢，也起源得很早，啊，到郑和下西洋的时候啊，它七次下西洋，到了30几个国家。
The Maritime Silk Road also has a long tradition. During Zhenghe's voyage to the Western Seas, he visited more than 30 countries.
我在英国当大使的时候，当时英国有一个学者叫 Menzies， 他写了一本书 1421。
When I served as a UK ambassador to the United Kingdom, I noticed a scholar in the United Kingdom who wrote a book called 1421.
他说当时郑和的舰队曾经到过北美，但是中国很多学者都不赞成，因为根据我们的历史记载啊，他到了30多个国家，并没有到北美。
He wrote in his book that Zhenghe's fleets even reached as far as North America. But this point was not agreed upon by Chinese scholars, because according to their research, Zhenghe visited more than 30 countries, but not reached North America.
但是无论是陆上丝绸之路还是海上丝绸之路，它都是和平、友谊、交流的象征。
Both the land and maritime Silk Road stand out as a symbol of friendship, peace, and exchanges.
当时就是把中国的丝绸、茶叶、瓷器带到了世界各个地方，同时呢，也把各个国家有很多好的东西介绍进了中国。Through
the Silk Road, China's silk, tea, porcelain, and other goods were brought to other countries around the world, and the good things about other countries were also introduced to China.
所以丝绸之路啊，不仅是一个通商的道路。 也是各种文明互相交流、互相学习、共同进步的道路。
In this sense, the Silk Road is not only a commercial route, but also a pathway for different cultures and civilizations to learn from each other and seek common progress.
那么，习近平主席提出来的一带一路，就是要发扬丝绸之路过去的光荣传统。 把建设一个新的丝绸之路、经济带和海上丝绸之路，来扩大中国跟有关国家的经济、文化各个领域的交流跟合作。The
ideas that President Xi Jinping promoted is meant to carry forward this fine tradition and build the Silk Road Economic Belt, Maritime Silk Road, so as to expand the economic, cultural, and other exchanges and cooperation with relevant countries.
当时习近平主席提出的一路一带啊，他又提出了五通，啊。In
addition to the Economic Belt and Maritime Silk Road, President Xi Jinping also mentioned five other things.
这个五通啊，第一个就是叫政策沟通。First,
policy coordination.
也就是说，沿路国家对于我们经济发展的政策也好，对吧？经济发展战略也好，国家政策也好。 应该互相沟通。That
means countries on the route of the Silk Road should have more communications regarding our economic development and national development strategies.
第二个就是货物要互通，就是我的货物也可以出口到你那，你的货物也可以出口到我这儿，货物互通。Second,
commercial exchanges and trade.
第三个就是道路相通，因为既然是一个丝绸之路嘛。 你的公路也好，铁路也好，今天来讲就是一个整个的基础设施建设要互联互通。Third,
infrastructure connectivity.
这里头包括就是铁路，包括公路，包括航空，也包括油气管道，这就是各种基础设施都应该互联互通。This
include rail, road, air, as well as oil pipelines.
第四个是货币。 因为货币是经济生活的血脉，货币要流通。Fourth,
currency, because a currency is the blood of economic life.
加强金融领域的合作，货币领域的合作。That
means we will step up financial cooperation and cooperation in regard to our currency.
最后一通就是民心相通，就是因为人民之间的友谊啊，是国家关系的基础。 老百姓之间相互了解，相互建立起了友谊，这样你的经济合作也好，其他文化交流也好，这个最重要的是基础。Fifth,
people to people and cultural exchanges, because the friendship and mutual understanding between our peoples is the very foundation for good state-to-state relations.
自从这个一路一带这个倡议提出来以后，得到了许多国家的积极响应。
These ideas were warmly received by many countries.
不光是中亚国家、东盟国家、中东海湾地区的国家，包括欧洲国家，对这个都很感兴趣。
Not only countries in Central Asia and ASEAN, but also Middle East and Gulf countries, and including European countries, have shown their interest in these ideas.
这个呢，它是一个战略倡议，它并不需要建立新的机构。 也不需要建立什么新的组织，而是就是在这几个方面，大家随愿意参加进来，我们都欢迎。这是一个开放的合作的一个设想。This
is a strategic initiative. It doesn't require any new institutions or organizations. Rather, it's an open and cooperative platform, and we welcome the participation of all those who are interested.
那么实际上呢，现在有很多项目已经在进行，比如讲，对吧？中亚土库曼斯坦的油这个天然气，现在一直是已经运到北京、上海、香港。Actually,
many projects are already underway. For example, the natural gas in Turkmenistan in Central Asia has been transported all the way to Beijing, Shanghai, and Hong Kong.
所以就是可以把现有的一些合作可以多纳入到这个战略倡议里头，从而不仅造福沿岸的国家，同时我相信对世界文明的交流、对世界经济的繁荣也会做出巨大的贡献。All
these existing cooperation projects can be incorporated into these strategic initiatives. And I believe the implementation of these initiatives will go a long way in not only bringing benefits to the countries en route the Silk Road, but also the exchanges between civilizations around the world, as well as economic progress.
而且他这个倡议是完全是开放性的，欢迎所有有兴趣的国家都可以参加。我刚才说，尽管郑和没到北美，但是北美的国家如果对“一路一带”感兴趣，我们也完全欢迎他们参加进这个倡议。
As I mentioned, these initiatives are totally open, and all countries interested are welcome to participate. Although Zhenghe may not have reached North America during his trips centuries ago, but if North American countries are interested in the Economic Belt and Maritime Silk Road, they are more than welcome to participate in these projects so as to promote cultural and economic exchanges.
Thank you. Right here in the front. Wait for the microphone, please.
Hi, I'm Dr. Donna Wells. I'm an expert in the Russian language internet. Does there exist a single map outlining China's territorial claims? And how old is this map?
有没有那么一张地图是明确地写明了中国所有关于主权问题的主张？那么这张地图，如果有的话，它有多老了？
中华人民共和国是1949年10月1号正式成立的。The
People's Republic of China was founded in 1949. It was founded on October 1st, 1949.
当然，你要说中华人民共和国从它成立的一天起，就有一张正式的中华人民共和国的地图。On
the date of the founding of the PRC, there was a map.
但是我想你也许是感兴趣的是关于南海，曾经有一个九段线，我想把这个九段线的问题也简单的给大家做一点介绍。But
I guess your point of interest is the nine dash line with regard to the South China Sea.
因为这个刚才我前面也讲了，中国的南海诸岛及其附近海域拥有无可争辩的主权。
China enjoys indisputable sovereignty over the islands in South China Sea and their adjacent waters. This is backed up by solid historical and legal evidence.
那么是中国最早发现，最早利用，最早对这些岛屿实施行政管理，实行管辖权，也最早命名的这些岛屿的命名也是中国最早命名的。China
was the first country to find, name, use, and exercise administrative rights over these islands.
从历史记载来讲，我们是很长很长时间一直对这些岛屿实行有效的管辖。According
to historical records, for a long time in history, China has exercised effective jurisdiction and administration over these islands.
但是二次大战的时候，日本发动了太平洋战争，并且当时占据了不少南沙、西沙的岛屿。
But during World War II, Japan launched the Pacific War and occupied a number of islands in Nansha Islands, Xisha Islands, etc.
但是呢，在二次大战结束以后，根据开罗宣言和波茨坦公告，被日本霸占的，不属于日本的领土，统统都应该归还原来的国家。
But after the end of World War II, according to Cairo Declaration and Potsdam Proclamation, all those territories stolen by Japan should be returned.
所以1946年的时候，当时的国民党政府就派了舰队到南海，重新收复，有的是重新命名了岛屿，恢复了对南海主导行使主权。还没回答完，你等一等。
In 1946, the then nationalist government sent a fleet to South China Sea to recover and rename some of the islands and resume China's sovereignty.
那么当时在这个基础上，国民党的这个政府部门就出版了一个地图，当时地图上有11条断续线。这张那张地图是1948年正式公布。
At that time, the nationalist government issued a map showing 11 dotted lines. That map was issued in
1948.当然后来我们跟越南已经成功的，就北部湾划界问题已经解决了，所以这个当然十一条断续线也没必要了。后来是九段线。
And later on, we successfully resolved the issue of Beibu Bay with Vietnam, so it was no longer necessary to have 11 dotted lines, and later the 11 was reduced to 9.
所以这个是历届政府都是坚持的一个主张。
This position has been held by successive Chinese governments.
而且我想指出的是，70年代中期以前，没有任何国家对这个提出异议。
I would like to point out in particular that before the middle of 1970s, not a single country had any objection regarding this.
之所以这个现在很多人来挑战这个九段线，它主要是为了掩盖他们非法占据中国南沙群岛这样一个非法性，为了掩盖这个，这个是我们中方绝对不能接受的。
Then why so many countries come jump up to challenge China's position now? Because they want to hide their illegal occupation of China's Nansha Islands.
但是我前面也讲过，中国对于解决南沙问题的立场没有任何改变。但是对有人在南沙发动挑衅行动，中国也不能不做出反应。
This is unacceptable, but as I said, China's position with regard to South China Sea and Nansha Islands has not changed.
而且我想啊,
if certain parties make provocations, then China would have to respond.
如果你有兴趣的话, 你可以不仅去看中国地图, 当时啊, 在70年代中期以前, 世界上很多国家出版的地图 都是这么标明的。
If you're interested, you may not only have a look at the Chinese map, but also many countries issued similar maps noting these islands that belong to China before mid-1970s.
你说为什么南中国海叫南中国海呢? 为什么它不叫别的海呢?
Why the name South China Sea? It has China, not other countries. This in itself made a strong point. Thank you.
Oh, let's try to get some people in from the back. The guy with the sunglasses there. Yep. Sorry. Wait for the microphone, please. And identify yourself.
Thank you very much. I'm Richard Feinberg with the Brookings Institution and the University of California, San Diego. The concept of a maritime Silk Road is a fascinating one. A Chinese entrepreneur, Wang Jing, was granted a concession by the government of Nicaragua to build a transoceanic canal that would it would move from the Pacific all the way through to the Atlantic and allow the biggest ships, container ships, to pass through the two oceans. I'm wondering if you might consider that future Nicaragua-Chinese canal as part of a maritime Silk Road, and whether the Chinese government might have a position on the viability and desirability of the Nicaragua-Chinese canal. Thank you.
Great disorder under heaven.
那还是我来回答一下啊。第一呢，关于尼加拉瓜要新开一条运河这个事情啊，我可能了解的情况跟你差不多，也许还不如你。
First on the new canal, I know as many as you do or even less.
但是呢，就是随着这个贸易的发展呢，需要有 更多的沟通的渠道，尤其是两洋之间这种沟通渠道，这是一种客观的需要。
As trade volumes jump, there will be the demand for more communication channels, in particular between the Pacific and Atlantic.
因为这个就是我们刚才讲到互联互通啊，互联互通对于促进贸易这个作用极大。
We mentioned the connectivity just now. Actually, connectivity plays a huge role in promoting trade.
互联互通其中就包括需要有更多的海上的通道。
Connectivity also includes more maritime routes.
像这个埃及的苏伊士运河，是吧？当年如果没有这条运河的时候啊，所有的船只都要绕好望角，而且好望角我也去过的，那个地方，这个海啊，并不是那么平静的。
Take the Suez Canal in Egypt as an example. Without this canal, all ships would have to make a big turn around the Horn of Good Hope. I visited Good Hope. It's not that tranquil, actually.
那么苏伊士运河建成以后呢，就大大的方便了这个州与州之间的经贸的往来。
And the Suez Canal greatly facilitated economic and trade relations between the two continents.
所以从我个人的观点来讲，我觉得如果有更多的、更便利的海上通道，这个会造福大家。
So personally, I believe larger amount of and more convenient maritime routes will bring benefits to all parties.
至于你刚才讲的，他们这些当地的国家是不是对丝绸之路有兴趣？ 我刚才讲了，丝绸之路是完全一个开放的一个战略倡议，谁有兴趣都可以来参加。As
to the second part of the question, whether those countries are invited to, are welcome to the Silk Road, as I mentioned, the Silk Road is an open strategic initiative. All those interested are welcome.
现在这个世界上的贸易啊，货大量的还是通过海运，所以海上的通道尤其重要。
When it comes to trading goods, lion's share goes through maritime routes, so it's particularly important.
哎，我讲起丝绸之路来，我可以给你们介绍一个情况，就是陆上丝绸之路啊，根据出土的文物，大量的都是茶叶啊、丝绸啊，瓷器就很少，但是海上丝绸之路啊，就有大量的瓷器。为什么呢？这个船运载瓷器比较方便，你这个骆驼运载瓷器啊，这个瓷器就太沉了。 而且路上容易破碎。
Speaking of the Silk Road, let me share with you one more piece of information. When we look at the Silk Road on land, according to the artifacts excavated, they're mainly tea and silk, and only a limited number of porcelain. But a large number of porcelain are transported through maritime Silk Road because it's more convenient for ships to carry porcelain. It will be too heavy and too costly for camels to do that.
所以海上通道的自由安全对于经济贸易非常重要。
So the freedom and the safety of maritime routes is of particular importance to economic exchanges and trade.
这我要顺便再回到南海问题，因为有人提出来南海的航行自由，南海的航行自由啊从来没有出过问题，并没有因为我们跟有关国家有争议而影响到航海的自由。中国的进口大量的是依靠海运，而海运绝大部分都要通过南海，所以南海的
Now let me come back to the issue of South China Sea, because some people have pointed out the issue of freedom of navigation in South China Sea. As a matter of fact, freedom and safety of navigation in South China Sea has never been an issue. It has not been an issue because of the disputes between China and relevant countries. As a matter of fact, China's imports, majority of China's imports come through maritime transportation, and a big part are through the South China Sea. So freedom and safety of navigation in the South China Sea is of particular importance to China as well, and we will do what we can to ensure that.
Okay, I think we got time for one more question. Let's see. Judy, I'm going to let you in, but you're on a tight leash. A question. Okay. The microphone in front, please. Go ahead. Get to it quickly.
Thank you. My name is Jin Ling Nguyen, with Voice of Vietnamese Americans. I'm American. And our Secretary Kerry has just met with your presidency in Beijing and talked about the interests of both countries. So I congratulate you for repeating what you just said. I would like to ask a question regarding the rule of law. And that has to do with three different issues that brought up by you. First, the rule of law in the maritime sovereignty in the South China Sea. And according to international records, China has signed many treaties certifying that Paracels and Spratly Islands belong to Vietnam. These are treaties dated in 1886 between the French and the Tang, the Ming Dynasty then. And then there is another agreement, at San Francisco Agreement, in 1951, after 1949. In that agreement, Russia has suggested that to give Spratly and Paracels to the south of Vietnam, which is below, to actually suggested to give it back to Japan, but they all decided to give it to Vietnam. So at the time, in 1954, Premier Chu Ân Lai initiated the divided line between North and South Vietnam, and the South Vietnam happened to be below the latitude 17. And because of that, Spratly and Paracels Island belonged to South Vietnam, which is the Republic of Vietnam then, which then was the ally of the US. And in 1973, in the Paris Agreement, according to the agreement, Spratly and Paracels Island belonged to South Vietnam. In 1974, China took Paracels by force. That is a violation of the UN clause. In 1988, China again took Gotmer by force. That is another violation of the UN clause by force. That is regarding the maritime sovereignty. Now, regarding the human rights, I would raise the question of the Tiananmen Square in defending of my Chinese friends.
That's not relevant.
And then human rights. I like to talk about human trafficking and many Chinese girls' baby were killed, and in that their place, Almost, I was told by Congressman Chris Smith that up to 100 million of baby girls Chinese were killed. And in their place, okay. Vietnamese women now being trafficked it's to Thailand and to China. So then another...
Jeannie, I asked you not to make me regret it. So get to the question quickly.
My question also has to do with the currency and the trading. Because many of Chinese trades had come to the Vietnam as a dumping ground. Vietnam has suffered a lot of dumpings from China. And also, I know that our Secretary Jack Lew now is talking to your President Xi regarding the RMB currency. And I know talk is cheap, and so does the RMB is also cheap. And action speaks louder than talk. Thank you.
Is there a question?
So that question, has to do with how do you defend your situation with the violations of the UN clause, mm-hmm. the violations of the trade agreement of currency of the WTO, and also the violations of human rights.
你讲完了没有? 你的问题啊，确实是讲得太长了，已经不是一个问题了，是吧？
I'm afraid your questions are way too long. It's not just a question.
但是呢，我的回答将尽量的简短，因为节省大家的时间。
But in the interest of time, I will limit my answers.
西沙群岛啊，是属于中国的，中国享有无可争辩的主权。西沙
islands belong to China. China enjoys indisputable sovereignty over these islands.
很遗憾的是，你刚才列举的很多东西啊，都跟历史事实不符合。我真希望你好好回去，认真的学习一下历史。Unfortunately,
those historical accounts you said run counter to history. I hope you will go back to refer to your history books.
现在我只想举一个很简单的例子。1974年，周恩来总理关于南沙群岛、西沙群岛发布了一个声明。Let
me just cite a simple example here. In 1974, Premier Zhou Enlai issued a statement regarding Nansha Islands and Xisha Islands.
当时不仅越南的副外长，和主管的司长，表示完全赞成中国的立场，中国关于南海，关于南沙群岛、西沙群岛的立场，而且他还列举了一些历史的事实，说历史充分证明这些确实是中国的领土。At
that time, the vice foreign minister, as well as a number of DGs of Vietnam, fully endorsed this statement regarding Nansha and Xisha Islands. They also quoted a number of historical facts to show that these islands are part of China.
而且在同一年，越南的范文同总理专门给周恩来总理发出了一个正式的外交照会。
In the same year, that is in 1974, the Prime Minister of Vietnam sent a diplomatic note, a formal diplomatic note, to Premier Zhou Enlai, endorsing China's maritime statement.
所以简单的讲，我对你的劝告就是回去好好再做一做作业，把这些事情先搞搞清楚，然后再来提问。
So my suggestion is that you go home, do your homework better before you come here to ask questions.
All right, well, with that, clearly we've resolved the South China Sea problem in our discussion today. Well, I want to definitely thank all three panelists for coming and sharing their views with us. I think it's very important that we do focus on this issue of building a new type of major country relations between the two sides in order that we might be able to facilitate a more civil discussion on many of these issues.
And also to think about how we're going to manage these tectonic shifts that are going on in the Asia-Pacific region with regard to political and international structural changes. So I hope you would please join me in thanking our three panelists, and we really appreciate the audience's active participation. Thank you.